Can you hear me?
Yes, we're here. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So, good morning, you all, and welcome back to the training on day four. I hope you are still fine. For the topic today is the principle and the concept of life cycle assessment and water footprint. So, you know, the invited speaker is still Associate Professor Dr. Thanvadi Suksaroj. So before starting the classroom, so please turn on your camera to take a photo together for today, please. Thank you. Please, everyone, turn on the camera, please. Okay, so may I ask Dr. Thanvadi to start the class, please?
Thank you very much. I can take this. Oh my, I'm just observe the country that you come from. So very, very happy to see someone from Philippines. Now I have the student from Philippines also. Someone from South Africa. Yes, I have the alum, the student who graduated. Indonesia, yes, right? Now we have the student from Oman also, and they are twins. They will from Bhutan also. Very, very nice. Okay, welcome you back to the Taiga International Training Course. So today's session will be the session continue from yesterday. And before I start the lecture today, so I received one question from one of you, and it's very I'm so appreciated for your questions. This is a very, very nice question and also very up to date. So I would like to start from the question response. So maybe is this a kind of that can recall you all for the yesterday's session. And after that, we will move forward, continue us to today's session. In yesterday's session, we learned about the carbon footprint. And I received this question after our class finishes. The moderator sent to me, there are one participant asked that, so how do we measure the carbon footprint at farm level? And I didn't see any woman in this course. And he mentioned that two weeks ago, the Dutch farmer were protesting harsh climate law. And so then yesterday we are talking about carbon footprint measurement. That I told you that, okay, this measurement tool, this is a tool to help any kind of organization, of course, for the farm, for the farmers, or the agricultural manufacturers to know their situation, their contributing to some kind of the impact. If we measure carbon footprint, it means we try to measure our status, how much or how many gases that we emitted into the ambience of the world. And of course, that gases is contributing to the endpoint impact to create some kind of the climate change and create the many consequent impact that you have been learned. There are the methodology to mature, not too difficult, but it is a need to understand about the clear scope. What is the thing that you would like to mature? So maybe I will attempt again during we learned about the water footprint. Okay, I will let's try. But from yesterday, for the simplest way and shortest to description, is it mean, for example, farmer have to know that all leaves of the item of the resources in terms of raw materials and energy that they're spending into the farm for their farming operation or for the production, their own production, how much water they use for watering, how kilogram of fertilizer, everything throughout the life cycle of their product or their operating cycle. And after that, you can use that quantity of each item multiplying with the emission factor that the scientists already done for us, or if they did not done or they didn't do like that for us. Also, actually, we have like some kind of material that or the laboratories, field laboratories instruments that can measure the carbon dioxide and other gas emissions. But actually, on the real way that the all country are doing is we try to gathering the database about the emission factor of all items that we use in our country. And so then the farmer can use that emission factor to transform the quantity of resources that they are using to be as the quantity of the greenhouse gases that they're emitting from the using of that thing. And in overall, the summations of all emissions from each item that you use in the farm, totally it is the carbon emission in the unit of carbon dioxide equivalent something. So we will attempt that again during the carbon water footprint. But first of all, I would like to talking about this question, okay, about the situation in Netherlands that the Dutch farmer were protesting to their government as the climate law. What is the behind scene of this situation? Maybe we just back to the slide that we have been seeing yesterday. That this is a source of the climate contributing gas or greenhouse gases emitted from agriculture, from crops and livestock. Greenhouse gases, normally in our era, when we are talking, we summation every gas to be as carbon dioxide equivalent unit. So you can see that, of course, the first source of the main source of greenhouse gases from agricultural sectors, this is the enteric fermentation. What is enteric fermentation? This is when the beef, when the cow is what feeding, and after that there are the digestion in fermentation inside their body. And when the cow burp or when the cow like release some gas, so they release the gas, especially the methane, into the ambient. So what is the problem if the cow burp? But is it no problem if we have only one cow? But you just imagine that if we doing the very, very big livestock estate, you gathering 1,000 cow or 1,000 beef, 1,000 sheep to stay together. And when the burp, it's like they are the bubble of greenhouse gases released together at the same time. So it's like you are just bombing the methane into the ambient. So it's like a factory. But the second rank is the livestock manure or the feces. So this is the origin of the Netherlands situation. The situation is, of course, we know that another part from methane and other gas. So the livestock also can create the nitrous oxide into the ambient, where the process of nitrification, denitrification, but original is come from urea or urine, actually the ammonia that the animal release into into the feces or the pee, something like that. And after that, okay, with the ecosystem mechanisms, after that there are some kind of transform the ammonia until reach to the form of gases, nitrous oxide. And then we have been learned yesterday. Nitrous oxide, in comparing with the quantity of carbon dioxide emitted into the ambient, may be very much lower, very, very, very huge, much lower. But the global warming potentials of nitrous oxide is very, very high, almost 300 times of carbon dioxide. Is it the ability of these gases to contributing to climate change over the 100-year period, comparing with carbon dioxide? So, apart from carbon dioxide, now for agricultural sector, methane and nitrous oxide, this is the main actor. And of course, in the EU, the European countries, there are so very strong commitment in terms to take action with very hard action in all sectors, try to reduce the greenhouse gases emission. So then when they are looking up into their country, and also there are some agreement among the European countries, it means their forces of sector in their own country try to reduce or cut off the greenhouse gases. So the problem is started from the Dutch government just passed the law that forces the farmer who are doing livestock in the area that they are defined as the vulnerable area. It means very near to the forest or the natural site. So the forces that the farmer who have the farm and doing the livestock near that land or in the map that they are drawing, is that mean they have to force that try to changing some farming practice to reduce the nitrous oxide emission from that animal. And it is encompassing with the target of the country, like other country in the world that tries to emit the zero of nitrous oxide within by 2050, something like that. So the farmer think that this is not fair, and they think that why they have to be a target, and why other sector like the industrial sector and other activity also release that nitrous oxide, and they just thinking that they are unfair, that the government have to point it to them. But the Dutch government answered to the farmer that, okay, the farmer have rights to do the protesting, but they cannot change the law. Especially this is the law that come from the agreement among the European country that they draw the map, cover many part of many country and including some area in the marine to it is to be the target area that every activity inside of that area have to take action very strong in terms to reduce the greenhouse gases emission. You see that, okay, a very, very, very hardcore government of the Netherlands, but it is depend on their own country context that I share you yesterday. It's like, okay, one factory of Thailand would like to send the crab meat, cannot keep meat into the Europe. And so then, even though any regulation did not force them to do the carbon footprint, but the Europe just mentioned that, okay, all of the products come into the Europe, comes into the shelf of France, have to declare the carbon footprint. So that you have to do. This is the regulation. But I said like this, it doesn't mean that every country has to follow Netherlands. So every measure that we will decide to do in our country have to be belong to us, belong to ourselves, and have to be designed with the very, very be careful to be as it this is the appropriateness measure to the country. But anyway, this situation to see that can show us that some country is really have very, very strong commitment in terms to try to reduce or cut off the emission of greenhouse gases immediately. Because like I told you, okay, we contribute at different level. For developing country, they emit very, maybe in comparing with some country, we emitted just a few level. And also we are not the significant emitter. But when the climate change coming, when the impact come over, come up, the disaster, everything, the sea level rising, everything, the water shortage, all that thing. They did not select, okay, your country is really friendly to environment, so you will be take a list. This is a, it's not like that. Everyone have to get the same impact. So that's why it is now in international platform and all policy header call for immediately action to all countries. Try to do everything that we can do as a base to cut immediately the emissions of greenhouse gases. So this is just information to share with you about the situation is occur in our world society. But of course, this is a response to the very our big challenge with the climate change. Okay, so we will back to the today's session. Okay. Yesterday you learned about the concept of carbon footprint. So today it is a water footprint. I'm so sorry that because that we have the limitations in terms of time. Normally when we teach our graduate student about water footprint assessment, how the days, and also the carbon footprint, how the days. So it's a quite take many days, and sometimes it take like a 1 week. But because all of you already some expertise and have very much experience in terms of the working, relate much or less about this. So so the main point of the organizer has tried to connect you with the concept that we would like to share and learn together. And after that, or maybe in the future, this is so will be expand to be the real work in your country with cooperation from Thailand, or maybe the Thailand can call cooperation from you all also that we are now as a Thaisa network, okay? So the water footprint, the basic concept is like the carbon footprint. So the main concept is when we are determining the any impact from area, from product, or from the people, from country, in which dimension. We have to thinking based on the load that they are discharging into the environment from the whole life cycle. Since the cradle to grave, since the birth until die, since they just was extracting from somewhere in the world until they pass the many processing to be as a product and until they sleep in the landfill. So we have to thinking about that. But okay, if sometimes we can cut off in some part of that their life chain to explore in deeper. For example, the factory, normally they're focusing on the factory scope. So then because they would like to see where is the hotspot that actually we emitted a lot of the something pollution, waste waters or carbon emissions or what something else. But okay, behind of that I told you before, we lead to the impact decreasing. So anyway, we can get immediately reduce the cost or reduce the resource consumed in our process. For water footprint, when we are talking with carbon footprint, it means we try to determine something that we are doing and related to the climate change impact. For water footprint, it means we focusing on the impact that's about the water shortage. So the water footprint is measuring of the water consumption. The water consumption. Maybe I have to declare you a little bit when we are talking about the water impact. Water impact. Maybe you have been heard the word that about the water scarcity, water stress, water list. Actually, these three terms is related, and but it is a focus in a little bit different point and scope. When we are talking about the water scarcity, water scarcity is mean when we are talking the situation of the lack of fresh water. We focus on the volume of water that we have, that we consume, and relate with the volume of available water in a given area. So just take the balance between available water that we have and the volume of water that we take. This is a water scarcity. So water scarcity occurs when we consume over the volume of available water resource in our area. This is a water scarcity. So does it mean quite focusing on the physical dimension of water, the volume quantity. But if we talking about water stress is considering several physical aspects beyond only volume, including, for example, we include considering about water quality also. Even though in your area you have estimated sufficient water volume to be used, but in the actual you see that even though we have a water in the liver, but that liver is very high polluted. So is that mean even though we have a water, but the quality of water, this is not appropriate to be used for our activity. So finally, the result is the same, we lack of water. So then is this water stress? Water stress is me considering the several dimensions, not focus only the volume. So normally we frequently familiar with the water state in academic documented, because we are thinking in terms of water security, we have to thinking more than just volume that we have. We are thinking about quality in terms of societal dimension. Even though you have water is very fresh and the quality is appropriate to be used, but in social dimension, how about the accessibility among the people? They are equitable to access that water or not? In Thailand, honestly, we also have that some experience of water stress in some area. Is it a fighting between different sectors, for example, industry and community? We have a fresh water, but when the industrial sector needs a little bit high volume of water to serve their processing, okay, some season is not a problem, but some season, some year, very dry, so it's very limited water. So depend on the policymaker in that area, that which one that they are prioritized. And of course, that is sometimes like the common feeling is money is important. So maybe we try to serve the part of production sector first, and so then the people have facing this water street, for example. This is a social dimension. So water street, including all of that. And water list is mean refer to the possibility that the water street or water scarcity will come up. Normally, when we are talking about risky, we are talking with two factors, how frequency and how much severity. Okay, for example, the severity of water strait or water shortage is very high, but it occurs one in the 100 times. So it means severity is high, possibility of frequency is low, so the risk is quite low. But if some area, very dry, frequently to facing with water shortage, and also each time there are some people, huge number got the effect from the water shortage, severity is high, frequency is high, so that area is very risky in terms of the water leak. This is the term that we are talking about, and of course this is related to the water footprint, because the water footprint is the tool that we try to apply to determine about the efficiency or the performance of some system and try to lead to the reduce the water leak, or try to design some intervention to protect the people, to protect the farmer to facing this high water leak. This is a philosophy of water footprint. And we have to accept that like climate change. So now even though now in Thailand a very cloudy sky, and we have raining along this week, the meteorological also forecasting that we have to facing this raining, heavy raining until this coming Sunday. But actually in overall picture of our world, we are facing this water strait, because there are some people in somewhere in our world still lack or late to access the fresh water that is very important for their living. And also based on the many factors, urbanization, the water consumption behavior, because now the world is more modernized, and we have the very strong trend that all parts of the world are moving to be the urban area. There are some scientists reports that mentioned that maybe in the next of 40 years from now, it means 50% of the global population they will live in the area that we mentioned that as the urban area. So very high density and very competitive in terms of the water, water and other resource accessibility. And so then the behavior of urbanized people is different also. We consume much of water because about the lifestyle and the thing. And encompassing with the other factor, of course, climate change is come as the factor to synergize the severity of water state in our world, because now the temperature is more higher and more unpredictable weather, extreme weather even. We need the water, but they're coming to us as a flooding. When we need them, they're gone as a drought, something like that. So very, very, and I'm not the irrigation engineering, but because my husband is, and also have a chance to talking and receive the information from them. So then, the host of the organizer of this course is the top institute in Thailand, only one institute in Thailand that are the experts about the irrigation. they learn about hydrological weather or something. And they say that actually, for example, I asked them that, so actually climate change makes Thailand have a less water. So then they say that, so the volume of water is not a problem because actually we still have land for very high intensity in some area, but the climate change, the important thing is the climate change the pattern. They fall when they don't need much, and they don't come when we need them so much. Is that mean the pattern of seasonal is changing? And why our country, it is the agricultural based country, and this the wisdom of the farmer accumulated since the 1,000 year, they know that this time, this month, you start to planting because the rain will come later, just a few weeks, just a few months. And so then when the plant growing up to reach the period that they need the much water, so the rain will come at the appropriate time. So this is a normal pattern, but now climate change that overall. So it's quite to make farmer also facing with water stress, because when they need the water, sometimes they did not have enough water. And so then the irrigation is come to be the technology that we have. Actually, it's the very big department in our country, even though Thailand is just a water prone area. It means we have a lot of the water resource. But irrigation is very important because we have to serve the water at the appropriate time, appropriate volume, in according with the farmer needs and other sectors also. So this is our make the our world more complicated, facing with many challenges. And if you see this slide is show about the projected impact from climate change. I just draw up in the block of the water that I just mentioned a little bit yesterday about the higher temperature. So now this make the mountain glacier melt a lot, and that water, that ice, that is actually it is a source of fresh water of our world. They provide the water we are melting in the summer. And so then with the enough volume, so they serve us with the sufficient quantity water throughout the year. And for the some part that already melted, they are be filled up with the coming snow or coming winter season. But now with the climate change, so now we cannot predict anymore precisely what where the rain come to fill in the dam, or when this winter coming will have enough snowing to fill up the grasses or not. So the situation that appears in our world every day, they reported about the small mountain grasses disappear day by day. So then the water supply are threatened in many areas. Of course, after that, when the longer summer and shorter winter is come up year by year, so finally, when the global temperature is increasing to be around 2 degrees Celsius, that I showed you yesterday. Now we the increasing temperature in average of our world is almost 1.5 degrees Celsius, and the next 2 decades, the IPCC forecast that we will reach to 1.5 degrees Celsius changes. And if we change it continuously until reach 2 degrees Celsius, so we will face it with the significant decrease in water availability in many areas, including Mediterranean and Southern Africa. And if we cannot cut off about the climate change impact, so finally, all of the iceberg and also all of the many parts of ice stock that in many parts of the world will be melt out. And of course, this water go to where? Go to the sea. So it will make the sea level rise 10 major cities, including Bangkok. There are some publications from USA since 4 years ago. I think it really shocked into many countries because they use some mathematical modeling to forecasting about the sea level. And we found that, for example, the Bangkok metropolitan, the capital of Thailand, will disappear from the map. It will be covered with the sea, something like that. This is a very, very big issue also. And compassing with the real information, very, very real that we know that in the water of that existing in our world, you know that just only 3% is the fresh water. 97% is the sea, is the salted water. So in terms of, is that mean, what is the salted water? Does it mean we cannot use immediately? We need some process to transform to be fresh water first. And so now in the current time, we have to accept that some technology is quite to be not appropriated to be as a commercial, so very, very high cost. And fresh water, 3%. That 3%, most of that existing at the ice form, iceberg, glacier in the high mountain. River and lake, just only 1%. 2% is groundwater. So does it mean if we took the definition of water resources, meaning that water resources mean the thing that we can access immediately and use them for our purpose. So then is it mean water resources in the world is very, very limited. And maybe, okay, someday in the many years from now, maybe we can leave the technology that can transform the salt water to be fresh water. But okay, at that time, maybe we have enough water, but not enough land to be living. So this is based on the scientific information that we know for many years, and we come up with the updated scientific information. This is a confirm that water stress or water is the one crisis that we have to take action immediately in terms to save the world. Okay, this is about to show the ratio of withdrawal of water to the supply water in the country, in the world, forecasting for the 2040. Okay, Thailand and some country have we call water prone area. It means have high volume of water. So it's the term of withdraw much or less. It may be not an impact much, but we have to accept that in some country that very high number of populations and still increasing continuously, even though they have the very high volume availability water, available water. But because of the increasing of population number, increasing of urbanization area, changing to be the modernized industrial countries, everything is a mix. Some countries have to do very high withdrawal rate of water. And of course, normally the withdrawal rate is directly related with the possibility of the water strait or water leak, something like that. And so it's a big challenge. In 2030, we aim at that. We can achieve to the sustainable development goals. And you know that the why the water really important, even though among the 17 goals, water take account one goal. The SDG number 6, that talking about we have to ensure the availability and sustainable management of water and sanitation for all. Availability, if it means enough of quantity. Sanitation, talking about quality. So this is under the SDG, there are many sub-indicators, and you will surprising that very related to the water footprint. Okay, that I will explain you later. So finally, in summarization, the water footprint show the action of water use. We measure the water using in relation to the consumption by people, not only people, by people, by sector, by company, by organization, by country, by region, by continent, by everything else. The water footprint can be performed in terms of the unit of individual, community, business that divided as the water volume of fresh water used or consumed to produce the food or service consumed by them. So it's a measure, normally they measure in terms of water volume consumed, including evaporated and or polluted per unit of time. Okay. So the water footprint, why they become as one of the main tools that we use to determine about the situation of water consumption in any level, and also will be the very effective tools in terms interpretation for policy advocacy or decide the sub measures to respond in terms of water stress. The consumptive water footprint reduction in irrigated crop production is essential given because we are increasing in terms of the competition for fresh water, as I described in the former slide. So now is mean the reduction of water footprint is mainly reduce the water consumption, especially in terms of the area that use the irrigated water. Because it is depend on the allocation, depend on the plan, depend on the management, something like that. And the effect of management practice can be determined by water footprint. Maybe you can have the many choice, many alternatives of the technologies can be applied into the farm, into the any kind of sectors or organizations. So water footprint can be as a tool to help the policymaker to pick up the most efficient technology. And also water footprint concern the whole system to life cycle. So it means let you know that the contributing of the crop production in water stress. And of course, this is the one tool that can support the sustainability milestone. We move forward to the sustainable development. In the water footprint assessment in sustainable development, as I touched a little bit in terms of sustainability, you know that okay, when we are talking about that, there are three pillars interconnect together. There are the environmental dimension, there are economic dimension and societal dimension. Is it mean if we move forward towards the sustainability, we have to take the balance in terms of development in all pillars. So for water footprint, is it mean if we are talking in terms of environmental dimension, is it mean we are focusing on water footprint allocation among all users and how we can protect the ecological and human society from the polluted water. For social sustainability, is it mean we have to thinking who is user, who is consumer, and how we can allocate the water for to them with equity. And also economic sustainability, is it mean how efficient that the water being used, because water have their cost also, especially if it is the irrigated water. This is come up with the cost of energy that we apply to distribute the water. Sometimes the water needs some treatment process to obtain the higher quality before using or before consumption, like a tap water. So water have a cost. The efficient using is necessary in terms of economic dimension. So then this term is related to to the thing that we have been talked today. So the concept of a water footprint, when we are talking about the consumption of water in any sector, is that mean you have to taking all. So in their life cycle, what is the life cycle of water? Water come up in the world from water cycle. Okay, maybe okay, after that, without treatment or not treatment, we took them to consume, to eat, to traveling, to product some goods or something. And so then some part of water is not main part, major part of water after that was discharged at the wastewater into the environment, back into the environment. So all of these steps has a cost of water withdrawing, a cost that we buy the water to be used by ourselves, and the cost of water treatment that pay directly by us or have to pay by natural. Natural have to do the self-purification when they receive the pollutant in the water that we discharge. So there are some mechanisms that the water ecosystem try to recover themselves, to do self-purification, to produce the fresh water, high quality, back to us again, serve us again. So the concept of water footprint have to taking account for whole of this life cycle. Is that mean you have to count it, the water that you consume. That water is come from natural source, or if that water come from the water that you are producing or improve the quality, and including the quantity of the water that you discharge into the environment. Because when we are talking in idealistic, is that mean we discharge the dirty water into the environment? Is that mean the environment have to keep some quantity of water to dilute that polluted water to be acceptable quality water? So does it mean some part of fresh water, instead to be used directly by us, they have to use to treat it their friend, treat it their polluted water? So does it mean we consume also fresh water at that stage, at that pollution treatment? So we have to take account all of this. This is a water footprint, water footprint assessment. So it means if Thai people have a water footprint 100 or 100 cubic meter per capita per year, for example, 100 cubic meters of water footprint per head, is it mean take account already all of the quantity of water that they are using, and also the quantity of fresh water equivalent that they use to treat it, water that polluted from their own activity. It includes them all. This is water footprint. And so then when we are talking about the water footprint, so we divide them to be three parts that we have to find out and summation of. Actually, the concept of water footprint now there are two frames. But the original frame of that is as I show you in this slide, to take account the water footprint for any activity or someone, some country, you have to finding how much water that they use, and that when that source, it is a natural water source like a raining water, precipitation, we call green water. So blue water is mean the quantity of irrigated water that they use. We divide it to be, you use this natural water, this part is irrigated water or processed water. And another part is we call gray water. Is it mean like equally to the fresh water used to dilute pollution? Is it the gray water? So we have to do the summation of green, blue, gray, and then it is the water footprint of the thing that has the target scope that we are assessing. So green and blue, we can compute it, summation to be as a consumable water, right? And for gray water, is that mean the water that we use to treat it, the polluted water, to be back to be the available fresh water, available resource for the next using cycle. So in terms of, for example, if we apply the concept to the farm for the planting the crop, so for the crop growing, for the crop cycle, of course, the water uses washing. They use rainwater. They use groundwater within the plant irrigation, cleaning, transportation. Maybe they receive the water from the natural. We have to take account because instead that we can use that rainwater, the plant is taking. So this is the water footprint of the plant. This is the rainwater. And blue water is that mean irrigated water. Is it come from the potted sod that they know? Come from the irrigated canal, come from the pond, or come from the pumping water, something that they use for watering the water. And also in the farming operation, of course, we apply the fertilizers, we apply the chemicals. So then when these chemicals were leached into the soil from the watering, and so that we apply the urea. And when the rewatering, okay, some part of urea absorbed by plants, but some part, some fraction was leached into the soil, into the environment. This is some part of urea that we apply. So then this is a polluted water that discharged from the plant, from the farm. So then we have to take account also how much the water that contaminated by fractionate urea that leached from the farm into the environment. All of these green, blue, gray have to account together to be the water footprint. And I will describe later in the interpretation why they have to divide it by these. And we can use how we can use this volume, this value to design in terms to increase the plant productivity or farming productivity, something like that. Okay. This is a show infographic of the global water footprint. Is it mean them? Now we are measuring water footprint in our country also. We monitoring because we try to convince all nations, all sector in the world, try to cut off in terms of the water higher or over water consumption too, because of we facing the water strait that I explained. So if you started from your left-hand side here, this is the infographic to show us about the amount of fresh water available. That you see that if we are take account that I, if you recall to the former slide, this is the same information. 3% it is the fresh water, and 1-2% it is the liver. So then you see that comparing that overall quantity, just only one drop, it is the leadiness available fresh water. Okay, the a little bit lighter blue, but not most lighter. This is the fresh water straw in the ice cap. This is a stock, our stock. After that, where blue light blue color, this is the salt water. So why someone says that water resources is limited resource? Because leadiness source, just very few, comparing with the overall part of water that we have in the world. And move to your a little bit on the right hand side. This part shows about the water footprint per capita, cubic meter per year. You see that? Congratulations, my country consume very much. Because okay, like I do, actually yes, water consumption I can accept that. Okay, we're not concerned much because you know that some part of Thailand, in the southern Thailand, my hometown, we have the rainfall intensity more than 2,000 millimeter per year. And in the okay general situation, a conventional situation, we have a rainy season 8 months per year. The late, is it okay, 2 months for the summer, real summer, very hot. After that, okay, two months is it for, okay, the weather is okay, not too hot, not too humid. And after that, 8 months, it is a rainy season. In the southern part of Thailand, I come from the southern Thailand. So we have only two seasons. Hot and very hot, you know. It is summer and rainy season. We don't have winter. 8 months it's raining. And sometimes, you know, that in the town that I have been living before, I moved to be the current staying place now. You know, that sometimes when the rain comes, and this is the raining, it's what raining. It's what raining without stop. For 5 days, do you believe that? Yes, this is the truth. So we can say that Thailand is a water prone area. We have a lot of much of the water resource. So it make a little bit less concern of the people about the water consumption. So water footprint of Thailand, you can see a little bit here, excellent, really high. And okay, another part, you saw in the some part, some continent of our world, they consume very less because of maybe very high capacity. So when we know that, it just mean, okay, water consumption concern, this is one of the national strategies of Thailand that have to try to cope with this situation. And you see that, there are also in the world some countries their life depend on imported water, so this is really more risky. It's like a Kuwait, Malta, Netherlands, Bahrain, Belgium. Sometimes it means like okay, maybe their water source is this transboundary source. It's sharing between many countries. Or like a Singapore now, 60% of water using in Singapore country imported from Malaysia, something like that. So it's a very, 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 you see that very, some factor very vulnerable condition for some countries. So then it mean like have to thinking. And also this part, so about water footprint from different food. You produce 1 kilogram of chocolate. You use 24,000 liters, around 24 cubic meter for chocolate 1 kilo. 1 kilo of beef use around 16,000 liters. 1 kilo of olive, 4,000 liters. 1 kilo of sugar, 1,400 liter. 1 cup of coffee, 140 liter. This is a water footprint. You see that? You can see like a carbon footprint. We have to interpret per functional unit. This is very, very high. And you know that? I just a link to the other topic that I am teaching to my student now. This is about the food security. You know that, okay, for example, beef or meat also consume quite high resources in terms of their production. But you know, the demanding of meat in our world is increasing traveling, because it's also related to the lifestyle of the people that is more modernized. When they are more modernized, they move to stay in the urbanized area, they are tentative to consume more meat, consume more sugar, something like that. So does it mean this demanding also together with the civilizations of our world? So then it makes our world to lead more higher continuous sharply increase of water footprint. And so then it's maybe with the challenge factor come up with the climate change and other. So the water state maybe it's not the easy problem that we can cope in this situation. So then that's why, many sectors try to present the infographic to the global commune to see that, okay, how are we being? And so then it means, okay, maybe we cannot just a saying anymore. We have to thinking and take action something immediately. And for the country also that have the large agricultural employment, so then the blue scarcity is one of the big challenge. That's okay, I can talk in because it's my country, Thailand. Okay, Thailand, the total area, this is the Laos, almost 30% of agricultural land. This is the irrigated land. And also the contributing of agriculture to total blue footprint of the country, you see, from agriculture, almost 100%. Because our country is agricultural based. So most of irrigated water in our country serve for farmers, because we are food exporter, food producing country. I think it is the same situation in many developing countries. We consume more water, but most of water actually we use for agriculture. So that's why water footprint and agricultural sector have to become to be embedded in that sector to do something with it. Some tools to determine and try to find out the coping strategies or measures to improve the efficiency in agricultural sector. And you see that also, normally we try to serve the plant with the amount of water that's sufficient for their growing and producing the fruit, and like that. So normally we try to control the amount of water because we need to achievement of production that we design. So, but in this situation now, you see that not only achievement of production is required, but in the societal condition and also many challenges that I already been talked. Now, environmental very concerned trade body barriers like a carbon footprint attached on permit sent to EU. At Denmark, you have the big farm and that farm have to competitive in terms try to reduce the resource and increase the income because it is a business competition. And sustainable development goal and the thing. This is the factor that forcing up we to do more efficient in terms of control amount of water to the plant. So is that mean not only design the or water apply to the plant depend on only the plant need, but now even though plant need 50%, but we have to try to reduce to be 40% to apply for them because there are many factors forces now the agricultural sector to try to be tight conditions to have to do about the water saving or water use efficient, more efficient water use. This is a water footprint, and also if we're thinking about carbon footprint, you see that you can compute the water footprint in many ways. For example, the water footprint of a product. So it means the sum up of green, blue, gray of water footprint in each state or process take account to the produce the product. So normally that we just come out with how much volume of water consumed per unit of product, for example. And you also can be, for example, if you would like to compute by consumer, by people. So does it mean you just take account the green, blue, gray that use in that area, in the such number of population. And after that, you divide by head counted. So then it will be to be per individual, per consumer. Or maybe we can compute it at the community, national consumption. You see, depend on what is the purpose or target that you would like to drive, would like to drive the policy to act on that. If you would like to license concern of the people in terms of the water consumption in the country, so the water footprint normally have to present us in the volume of water consumed per capita, per head of people. And if we would like to know that how we can improve the efficiency of the water or resource using in the farm in terms to produce our product. So normally product water footprint presented in per unit of footprint per unit of product. This is appropriate, something like that. Carbon footprint also can interpret per capita, per country, per area, per product, per organization. Water footprint is same. If you, for example, if you are working in one organization, one company, you can also compute the carbon footprint of organization because you just take account every activity that you use in that company. So normally in the company, like a business organization, what is they consume? They consume what? For 1 year of operation, they consume electricity. They consume water. They consume paper. And also have to account it for the staff that come to working at the office. They come by what? Vehicle. They pull the car or they come from what thing? And count it all of that. This is the footprint of organization. If you're focusing on water in terms to multiply with the emission of water, it's the water footprint. If you multiply it, the emission factors of carbon dioxide equivalent emission, this is the carbon footprint. If you are accounting all resources, all impact, the impact in terms of toxicity that can interpret also, you depend on the many footprint, many kind of footprint together, we call life cycle footprint. So depend on the purpose that we would like to scoping to assessment. So can assess farm, small farm, bigger farm. And also this tool have the one of the natural common characteristics like other environmental tools. Does that mean these tools can exist in many, in all scale? If you have a small farm who produce the potato and another farm is very big company, but produce potato also. So you use the water footprint to determine about the potato production from their farm. Farm A very small. So then you presented that potato water footprint is 1 cubic meter per kilo, for example. But in the that company, okay, they produce maybe much more potato, but when computing the water footprint, they consume 2 cubic meter per 1 kilo of potato. So farm A is more efficiency, more higher performance, even though they are the smaller farms. They're more environmental friendly. Something like that. That is when like this, so the firm A and company B can be the competition partner in the fair measurement platform. And so then this is when some country have set the regulation that, okay, the product that sent to our country have to declare the footprint, carbon footprint, water footprint. So if you can declare it, is it mean never mind you come from the small factory or big factory, but if you can declare it and you have met the regulation in terms of level limit or something, you can export and sell in that country. This is become a trade barrier, but also it is a tool for the trade fairness or trading fairness also, and can be give the opportunity to the small business can be to become up as one competitor in the global market. Okay, so this is just to show you what kind of the output from water footprint interpretation. After we sum up of green, blue, gray, this is a water footprint of potato. So then is that mean most of potato production producing water pollution. So it means if you would like to improve the performance efficiency or any kind of indicators to improving the potato farming, first of all, is it mean try to reduce the polluted water in the farm, because it's the main part of their water footprint. And you can see that the potato planting depend on green water more than blue water. Is that mean they use the rainwater as the main source of water consumed in the farm? Okay. It is a water footprint per capita. Okay, so it's been to be a benchmark. So when every country computing the water footprint, water consumption per head of population, so then you can get the average value. That is the red line, the global average water footprint. So which country that is the point is higher than global average, is it means there will be challenges to reduce the water consumption, right? So then some country that already have the less than global average, so maybe we have to learn some practice from that country. What happened, how they can do. And if every country after get this information, so the higher water consumer try to reduce their consumption, why the country that have less consumption try to maintain their status or try to reduce more. So finally, if every country do together in terms to try to reduce their water footprint per capita, so then maybe in the next 10 years or in the next decade, so then the global average value will be reduced. And when the water footprint reduced, is that mean, our world is consumed less water. So then the impact of water stress or water shortage, maybe it will be being, but less impact to the country, something like that. Because we have more resilience. We need less the water. Okay, is that mean we can more resilient to being in the condition that the water is very limited. Something like that. And this is the water footprint interpretation comparisons among food products. Is it mean, just to take considerations of the human food. And we found that, the more water footprint of the food product that we are eating is meat. It is the first length, followed by some legume or some veggies, cabbage, and after that poultry, egg, rice, corn, banana, orange, and potato. You see that? So is it mean that we have to try to arranging, or if we would like to, for example, if I am the global leader organization to set up some policy And if we cannot, we have to design the target sectors that we try to reduce the water footprint. So then maybe we considering the livestock as a first, because this is a hot spot. Is that mean they're trailing the major part of the water footprint? Comparing that, you reduce the water consumption in potato, you can reduce 10%, and you can reduce 10% in livestock. Oh, it affects a lot. You see, this information also can leading the policymakers to see some view appointed to make decisions. Like us in the Dutch government, right? Because of when they make the decision, who is the target that have to enforce the law to reduce the nitrous oxide from the agriculture. So then they prioritize based on the vulnerable area that the farm are located. So that farmer that were protesting is because they come from the area that their farm are located nearby the natural protection area. Something. This is the first. So for like this is a useful of this tool. Water footprint. Okay, if we go through just only scope of one product. Okay, as the carbon footprint that I showed you yesterday. So based on the whole life cycle of beef production. So then where the water footprint come from? Okay, this infographic from Weinberg showing that 95% of beef water footprint existing in the state of feed production and cow calf or some part of cow calf and stock food. After that, for the feedlot processing retail consumer, so is that mean like just a 5%. So I mean, if we would like to take action to reduce effectively of the water consumption in the beef production life cycle, we have to focus on the farm. On the farm. Okay, in not maybe it's a less benefit to try to support the consumer, like try to reduce the beef consumption, because actually the water footprint is attached in that state. So water footprint or carbon footprint can be shown like this. But water footprint have another special dimension of the interpretation than carbon footprint, from my opinion. So what is it? What is it? Okay, maybe this is a simple way to apply the water footprint. For example, when you get when you determine already the water footprint, if it is one scope, like one farm or one product. So then, based on two life cycles, of course, you can define the hotspot, because it is a tracking, back footprint. So this is, you can define the hotspot. Like, in the former slide, for the beef production, 1 kilo water footprint existing mainly on the farm. So we have to go back to the farm and digging for the deeper detail. After that, we can find solution. For example, maybe it's come up from the some parts of water consumption. When we find, so the, we try to decide the solution. What solution going forward? So actually, this solution or the measure or any kind of technology that we apply to that hotspot, does that mean we doing to reprocess? We apply in the that process, and so then it will make the water footprint reduce. This is if we comparing internal of our process before and after, we call internal benchmark. And if you have the group of farmers, you have a group of companies and produce at the same product or operate at the same business, so you can comparing with your friend company, the farm of your friend. If they have less water footprint. Is that mean there are some practices that are more efficient than us? So we can share and learn together, learn, share and learn together. If you can remind yesterday's session that I showing my experience about the carbon footprint of the smoke and rubber sheet corporation factory, that I told you that we have around 40 factories around the country. So is that mean when the one factory use the biogas system to reduce the carbon footprint from water treatment plant and can save the firewood to use for the smoking room, so then they can share this experience to another factory that have higher carbon emission. So like this, the water footprint also can do that, can do that. But water footprint have another special character. This is very interesting. Even though I am not a hydrological expert or the irrigation engineering, but based on my experience as the environmental scientist and environmental technology consultant, all of the environment tools that we use to apply in terms to reduce the impact from our sector, especially the agricultural sector, the very charming of this characteristic of their characteristic is their philosophy. You can see that when you learned about the carbon footprint, asks you to computing the emission of each stage of the life cycle. They did not divide it, okay? They divided at the stage of life cycle. This is a come from the raw material. This is the processing, consumption, and disposal, something like that. But they did not divide where is the resources come from. They did not divide it like that. Okay, this is this cell. Okay, this cell will come to this cell. And this cell have a carbon footprint because they have their own footprint since they was produced in the some petroleum factory. And also they have the footprint during their combustion. So they emit the direct carbon footprint. So then carbon footprint just divided by the life stage, copper life stage, and copper the direct is it mean like a combusting and carbon dioxide emitted. Or when you open up the Coca-Cola bottle, there are some carbon dioxide that they are present during the processing come out. We have to take account that this is a direct emission. And indirect is that mean the carbon emission or greenhouse gases emission that acted in their body become to the process like a fresh banana have their own footprints in the farm. So just only that. But you see that the carbon footprint, the water footprint divided the consumable water part to be green and blue, to be green and blue. So what the green and blue tell us about? There is a tell us, this is a green, this is a mean. You consume from natural water like a rain, actually it's a rain. And blue is a mean, this is the water that it is the irrigated water or processed water. Okay, so what does it mean? And okay, this is a gray. This is talking about the wastewater. Wastewater quantity. So they're divided at the green and blue. What's important that to know about what is the source of the water that the plant consume if you are the farmer. If you are the farmer. Okay, you have your own farm to produce some crop. And you have your water footprint. Okay, you consume. You computed the water footprint, or maybe per product. You produce the per unit of product, kilogram of product. Like, okay, you produce the rice, you have the paddy farm, you produce the rice per kilo. And to come up with the water footprint value at the final, so you have to compute the water footprint on green, water footprint on blue, and water footprint on gray. So if, for example, the final water footprint of your farming product is 100 cubic meter per kilogram of product, and you found that your product consume the green, consume the rainfall 50%. You are consume blue or irrigated water at 30%. And you contributing the water footprint from wastewater or polluted water about 20%. What does it mean? Does it mean that in the part of water footprint as a green section, very important, because based on computing the water footprint of rainfall consumption, okay, it's quite complicated than carbon footprint, because the need, the someone that to know about some kind of hydrological tools or some kind of to compute it, how much the rainfall that the planting consume into their body. So maybe you recall to the first session that Ajahn Vala was talking about the top what software, for example, to compute the water footprint in the part of green. You need the computing how much the landfall that the water consume. So CropBot, this is a tool that can help you to calculate water footprint in the term of green, because there will know what is what, but actually not only CropBot, there are another tool, another software that can be used also. But what is green normally can determine into two ways. First, tier one, they're computing from water that the plant needs, right? Second, you compute from effective rainfall. Is it the rain that the plant can use? So which one that we should be used? Is it depend on the condition? Is it depend on the condition? For example, if when you know that normally in the theoretical knowledge, when you planting one crop, there are theoretical value that they say that what kind amount of the water that the plant needs for growing in a such period, for a such that period to growing up. So you know that you need that they need. In comparing, for example, if you add information to set in the CropBot model that show you about, okay, this is the water that the plant needs. And CropBot also computing. This plant was planting in one city. And that city have rainfall to provide the water in a such volume. If the rainfall is less than planned volume, so does it mean when the rainfall falling precipitate, so all of them normally the plant is take all because it's not enough. This is not enough. So then you can use the effective rainfall at the tier 2 to compute water footprint in the green part. But if this city, the rainfall intensity is provide the volume of water more than the plants that are growing in that city, more than, much more than that the plant needs. So is it mean there are some part of rainfall absorbed by plant and another part may be discharged into the as a runoff. In terms of that, you use the value of plant needs to be as a green water footprint. So in terms of water footprint, it's required to be closing and have to be cooperate with the irrigation engineering. And also another interpretation from this one. Okay. Into two cases that I explained to you. For example, okay. In the case one, if your plants are planting in the area that rainfall is less than plant need, what does it mean? It needs irrigated water to supplement, to be a supplementary water. So increasing blue footprint because depend on less on green because intensity of rain is less than, provide less than water needs. But in tier two, if rainfall provide more water than plant needs, so is that mean blue footprint is less because no need irrigated water. In Thailand, I can provide you the example. The rubber tree, the rubber that provide the rubber liquid. Okay, they need much of water to planting and growing up the rubber tree in Thailand. And for example, to produce the rubber block or rubber smoke sheet like yesterday, you know that we have to planting the rubber for 7 years without harvesting and have to waiting until they grow up to a such of age. And after that, you can, start to harvest the rubber liquid from that tree. You know that these plants require very high volume of water for growing up the rubber. So then, even though there are the very high water footprint, but the prone area for the rubber planting in Thailand is Southern Thailand. As I told you that my hometown or my region, there are rainy seasons along 8 months per year. The intensity of rainfall more than 2000 millimeters per year. So then, even though the rubber plant, okay, this is Thailand. Normally the rubber plant, original, we planting in the southern part of Thailand, this is the Phuket, my hometown. The rubber plant need very high intensity of water. So then when they are planting in the southern of Thailand, that very, very has heavy rain many times in the year. So then even though it is very high water footprint, but it is no problem, no water stress in the southern part of Thailand because 100% of rubber tree is green because in the southern part of Thailand, available water have more than the volume that water needs. No problem. But in many years ago, around 7 or 8 months, almost 10 years ago, the lumber price in the global market is increasing sharply. You know that? Okay, for example, from $1 per kilo of lumber, they're increasing to be triple, $3 per kilo, from $1 to $2. And normally, one farm, so they produce, sometimes it's like a small farm is produce around 20 kilo per day. So the income of the farmer is very, very high. You know that in that time, the Thailand government have the policy to support the expansion of planting area of rubber tree to another region in Thailand, to northeast, to the north. And also, even though some part of the way, because cost the money, income of the rubber farmer at that time, or they become as a rich farmer because the very high cost, because there are the flooding in China that also have the very large rubber planting area, and also flooding in Vietnam that is the rubber exporter also at the time. And as I told you, 7 years, this is the year for the rubber maturity plant to be in start to harvest. So that time is the golden period of the Thai rubber farmer. And so the government, okay, have the policy to expand the rubber garden to the other region, like a north or northeast. That before north and northeast, this is the area to planting other rice or rice or maybe sugarcane and another thing. And at that time, what happened? In the former, okay, when the water footprint, even though high, but 100% is green. And also, we have enough of heavy rain to provide enough water. No water straight in the southern part of Thailand for rubber plantation. But in the northeast and northern Thailand, it's different. The intensity of rainfall is much greater than southern part of Thailand. So it doesn't mean at that area, sometimes the water footprint, they're still high because it is the same plant, it's rubber. They need very high water footprint, high consumed water. And also this one, in the northern part or northeastern part of Thailand, there are less rainfall, very short rainy season. This is dry land because a little bit high in terms of the level from the sea. So in terms of this, the available water have less than plenty in that area. What happened? Is it mean the irrigation department have to fill up blue water for this garden in this area? And what is blue water? Blue water is irrigated water. So it means you have to sharing from other sectors, from other plants, from rice, from paddy farm, from another farm, from livestock, from another agricultural that already sitting before the rubber plantation come here. So it's totally different situation. So then, is that mean water footprint, when they divide to be green and blue, actually, we can use them to trying to design the appropriate area. When this determine the green water need, so it means if that plant need very high water footprint, need to consume very high volume of water. So that plant should be located to planting in high intensity rainfall, because it makes them to depend much on rainfall, not sharing irrigated water. And if, okay, the plant that okay already planted in that area, but that area is less rainfall, is that mean you have to design very well irrigation system, or have to apply or support the farmers with irrigated technology, or maybe to help them to increase the efficiency of water consumption in their farm. So this is the charming of the water footprint assessment. Let's go through. So for the water footprint rule, is very easily, because it is irrigated, so we can be record how many the water that we withdraw for the irrigated system and divide it by the yield. So you will get the water footprint as the mean cubic meter of water per ton of product. And for the water gray water footprint in the part of gray footprint, as I explained to you, this is depend on the how application rate of the chemicals that the farmer apply into the farm, and also is multiplied with the alpha or the leaching runoff fraction. 100 of fertilizers of chemicals that apply into the farm, not 100% that absorbed by plant. There are the some fractionate that leaching into the environment. So back to the yesterday that I talked to you about the okay one kind of the challenge issue in the farming around the world is the overuse of fertilizers. So is it mean because the farmer would like to confidence that the plant receive the enough food, so then they will growing up well and provide a big fruit, high product, something high product volume to their farm. But the overuse of fertilizer is that mean higher runoff fraction. Is that mean contribute to the pollution into the environment more? So one of the cutoff of emission of farming that call for into the every country is try to help the farmer to design the precise chemicals and fertilizer application in their farm, not apply with their own feeling or their own experiment, because now we are come up at the point that we have the knowledge enough to support the farmer to deploy, we call the precise farming technology. And also, even though the case that I shared to you about the banana farming, that I, you know, that after the calculations of the carbon footprint, they're contributing much from the main part is the farm, and this is about the fertilizer consumption. And fertilizer consumption, of course, in terms of economy, is costly. In terms of environment, more runoff friction into the environment if that water is not captured, is not treated. And normally the farming wastewater, we did not treat. We didn't just discharge into the environment. So is it mean this is the pollution that the farming contribute to the ecosystem. So based on the quantity or the application rate that apply into the farm and multiply with the leaching runoff fractions of the chemicals, divided by the maximum acceptable concentration. Is that mean the maximum of concentration of that that chemicals or that component in the natural system that we have acceptable. So normally it's come from like water quality standard or regulation, something. And also we have to make fairness to the farming discharge by we have to minus the acceptable concentration with the natural concentration that already existing. Because the water in the natural is not very clearly 100% no or zero contamination and not like that. They also have already contaminated by the natural substance that have the familiar with the structure of the chemical. So we have to minus that. And the white again by you. This is a gray water. This is it. So how can manage the gray water in the case of potato in the former slide that have the very high contributing from gray water from potato farming? We treated that wastewater. We treated before discharging. Or if it's possible, treat it and recycling. Reuse into the farm, to use at the farm, no discharge. So then you can cut off the water footprint gray suddenly. If you use the rainfall 100%, you cut off the blue water footprint, as it means provide more available irrigated water to other sections. And if the plant needs more water, so try to zoning the area that have enough water for them. Not like the experience about the rubber plantation in Thailand. But now we already back to the baseline status. Is that mean okay? Now the policy to expand the rubber plantation is stopped. After the, okay, China, Vietnam is recovery from the flooding 7 years now. So the rubber price in the global market not quite high because we have the more exporters come to sharing the market share. Vietnam also export, China or Indonesia are very large area of rubber plantation. So then Thailand still be the main exporter, but we have to sharing the marketplace with other countries, not like 10 years before. And also the policy to expand the crop plantation without will take considerations about water footprint, for example, will make another problem, a consequent water stress problem for the other sectors and other farming types, something like that. So this is a charming of water footprint that can be, okay, not just only assess and only, oh, okay, get the number or the value of water footprint, not like that. But we can, okay, use that information, track back to see the hotspot, to see the key finding behind that one, behind that value, and can use them to apply, to embed in terms of policy advocacy or design the appropriate measures to help the farmer to being more resilient in terms of the context of many challenges come up. And after this, after my session, okay, you will learn many technologies about that can be applied into the farm, especially about the water saving. So you mean you just attach the later session and former session, like Ajahn Warawut, okay, you attach together and you will see the way or the approach that we can design or intervene with our farmers to improve their efficiency, especially in terms of water consumption and also carbon footprint. It explains to the carbon footprint assessment also. Okay. So it's just to show you the case study in from my research also, from my our team research. That is about evaluation of water footprint of rubber block. This is a factory produce another type of rubber. Yesterday, you see about the rubber smoked cheese. So this one is in the processing in the factory is the rubber block. Also, it's a part some kind of process. And you see that based on the water footprint calculation, we found, okay, first, this one. This is existing in the factory to transform the fresh latex, fresh rubber liquid to be the rubber block dry up and just like to make as a block, right, that can send to other countries also. And first, let's take quantity. First of all, we don't know. So as a life cycle, if we would like to know the first latex or first rubber liquid water footprint, we have to go back to the farm. And in the farm, we have to take account the water in the soil preparation, rubber plantation, 7 years without harvesting, about the plantation management, I have to apply fertilizers, some chemicals, also, and tapping that have to add some chemical added after tapping immediately to preserve the quality. And after our research project found out for the first latex, most of its carbon footprint is come from green water. They consume rainfall. So if it is planting in southern part of Thailand, no problem. High rainfall intensity. But if growing up planting in dry area, maybe has a problem. Because if the natural cannot provide green, does it mean we have to add or supplement blue for them? Find out the water to feed them. So that's why, so now the southern Thailand still be at the appropriate area, or that will be the most appropriate area for the rubber plantation in Thailand based on this one. Okay. And okay, this is just okay. Finally, we can come up with the summation of water footprints in the farm. Water footprint from the state of plantation. And after that, okay, have to summation with the transportation and together with the process water footprint. So finally, and also you see that this is the gray water here, gray water here, gray water here. All of these become at the water footprint of rubber block. And so it is a value that we attach into the Thailand production and send to selling in the foreign country, exported to the other country. So I just to summarize again. So actually, even though it's quite to be like, okay, it seems to be not complicated much, the tool for assessment. But if we touch upon that philosophy and try to digging out the findings with the rationale of the context of application, water footprint or carbon footprint can be used for crop zoning, especially water footprint, as I already explained to you in terms of green water evaluation. And of course, when you know that, okay, what is the water footprint? What is the carbon footprint? So then maybe the precise technology, what point that needs the precise technology or smart farm to be applied? Maybe if the farmer don't have enough money at the beginning, maybe you have to find out, we have to find out, help them by find out the hotspot. Okay, what point that they consume much in terms of resource? So we maybe started some of the smart technology or precise technology to help them from that point. Consume much water. So watering with the precise quantity can be reduced the total water consumption. Okay, maybe you will learn later, not in detail with the other lecturer. Okay, just changing some farming techniques for the rice plantation from the all the time submerged into the water to be wet and dry, just like that. So it means just provide the precise quantity of water to the rice at the appropriate period. So finally, so they can reduce overall water consumption or water footprint for that crop cycle. Of course, in this part of the blue water, this is the thought for the water consumption in agriculture. This is an irrigated water. So then have to try by out the water, increase the water use efficiency. So simplify is increase productivity, consume the same quantity of water, but can produce more products. So then it can be reduced the water footprint, blue water footprint certainly. And for gray water, maybe some kind of treatment, like some of the sheet, instead of the discharge into the pond, waiting the rain to become up overflow. So then just treat it as the biogas. So it's cut off of the water footprint and can gain off some renewable energy, alternative energy to use in the process in addition, and can save more the firewood finally. So all of this become up as the synergized benefit for the farmer at the final. Okay. And of course, if we back to the SDG target, that is the our common target that we would like to achieve in the 2030. Okay. No one left behind, no country left behind. You see that in the target about water quality and pollution. So it's related directly to the gray water footprint. That is the indicator to mention about the water efficiency in terms of pollution pollution treatment. And in terms of water use efficiency, water scarcity is related to the blue water and green water sampat, for my opinion. So it means can apply, for example, if you apply blue water footprint in the product, so you can comparing with the former data internal benchmark or comparing with the friend company, this is the external benchmark, to find out or sharing the experience to save the resource, save the money, and provide more environmental friendly product. Okay, so this is immediately benefit and also long-term benefit from applications of this environmental tool since yesterday, carbon footprint and water footprint. Okay, this all is my lecture for this session. So hopefully that you can gain some beneficial information for apply in some part, less part or main part in your work in the future, or maybe our cooperation in the next future. Thank you very much. And so then maybe this time, if we still have a little bit time, maybe we can open the floor for some questions, one or two questions with a short, not long for time. Because after that, I also, because I would like to sharing much as I can my experience to you. So today also I have the experiment for you, but very easily, like today, if someone already tried. So you have any questions now? Or if still not have, okay, like yesterday, you can leave your message about the question. By email, by now in the chat box, or even though actually you can chat in Google Classroom also. So I will stop to sharing the lecture, the lecture file, and I will open up the experiment, the exercise for this session that I already post in the Google Classroom also. Just a moment. Oh, that's okay. Okay. Okay, maybe I explain you a little bit about the guideline for doing the exercise. I will sharing my screen. Actually, this file already appear in the Google Classroom already. At the assignment for the session four. And so then this is still sharing on PowerPoint? Really? Okay, just a moment. I'm sure sharing again. Why? Is okay? Okay. You see that it that I provide in the exercise, or maybe just attempt you again about the life cycle thinking. So you can see that in the first page, this is about the experiment of attempts about life cycle concept. You see that I just provide the photo of A. So the life cycle thinking, what is it? You have to thinking back, throw back from the A, where the A come from. Come from the hen. So we will get one hen. So we have to give them what they think. The hen can grow up by animal feed. We have to give them some antibiotics to prevent the hen to be from the sickness. And we have to provide the electricity for their coop to be warm, something. And appropriate temperature for them. And animal feed come from what? Come from grain production, from farm planting. So I just to ask you to filling up the possible of the life cycle chain from A. So you see that from this code, after you fill up, and if we, for example, we start to compute the carbon footprint or water footprint, does that mean all of these blocks have to be accounted to calculate their inventory or the quantity used in the life cycle. And after that, multiply with the emission factors, and so then you will come up with the value. And also, this is a later part. This is about the simple examples for exercise for water footprint calculation. This is a process to explain about producing 1 ton of paddy. 1 ton of paddy is a functional unit. So there are the steps until we get the lice or the harvest. So we provide you about all resources and raw material, or eventually that used in the such area of rice farming. For a such area, 1,600 square meter of this farm, one cycle crop, they consume like this, consume water, this one, seed drink, urea fertilizers, and the thing. And we obtain 0.8 tons of paddy from this resource consumption in this area site. So first of all, maybe you have to change the produce have to be converted if it is a 1 ton paddy. So finally, they need how much of the resource consumed on the column left hand side. So first of all, 0.8 ton of paddy obtained from 1,600 square meter. So if we need one ton of paddy, it is a functional unit. So how large area we need, and how large area we need, of course, have to increasing the resource consumed in the column left hand side, because it is only for 1,600. If we need more paddy, we need more large area, we need more large resources. So you just compute it, and after that, I provide you about the footprint factor to see that, okay, if you use 1 kilogram of seeding, so normally you already have the seeding water footprint allowed 3 cubic meter. If you apply pesticide have their own water footprint allowed 10 cubic meter per 1 kilo of pesticide. So after that, you have to transform the value in the heading number one, to be the appropriate functional unit inventory, and multiply with the assumed factor. After that, you can answer all questions. Right or wrong is that not the matter. But if you would like to be more clear understanding about the limited time lecture for me, so then is it mean this experiment can be helped to get more clearly from the state of okay, like a perceive and understanding of the content, but to understanding to be embedded in deep mind, we need a little bit of exercise. So this is all my session target. Okay, so then I provide all this exercise in the Google Classroom, including yesterday's session, one exercise very short about the carbon footprint, and today also it's not much, but okay, hopefully that you can enjoy this exercise, and also can leaving the questions that I will leave the answer for you later. Okay, is ARP activities. Okay, I got one question, and I will need the time to find out the best answer that can help you to understand. Okay, thank you very much, and hopefully that one day we can meet in person.
Thank you, Dr. Thanvadi. For the all participants who cannot get in the Google Classroom, so please send by your emails in the box, in chat box. So that after that I can let you get in and the classroom later. Okay. I have one with pressure and another one who cannot get in the Google Classroom, so you can send me your email in the chat box, and later that I will help you to let in the classroom. Okay. That's all. Or you can send me by email again. Okay. Thank you everyone for these sessions. Thank you everyone for this session. So hope you enjoy and hope you are satisfied, and see you tomorrow. Okay. Have a good day. Okay. Bye-bye.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Stay safe.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you, Doctor.